First of all, I want to say a big thanks to everybody who made this possible, to MAMA and also the Economic Institute, and especially, of course, to Matko and to Paul for organizing everything. And we have heard already quite a few laudatios about Matko Mestrovic, and as almost nothing I can add, and I want to keep it short, but allow me one personal remark relating to this image. About 5 or 6 years ago, initiated by an exhibition that Darko Fritz did in Graz, I started to research new tendencies quite seriously and had the opportunity of interviewing Matko on Korčula. He came to visit us and we did an interview. And then out of that developed something almost like a small tradition. Then with every year, we went to Korčula on holiday and Matko came and we made interviews, we corrected texts, and Matko showed us he's not just a great theorist, he's also a wonderful cook, and we had a kind of big fish lunch and everything. And out of that, the work developed. And then last year, the work was done. My PhD was finished, it was accepted. No more work to be done, Matko came, so what shall we do now? Actually, we went on a little excursion, and we went to the house where probably he was born in Brna. I don't know if I explained. So that's a small village on the south coast of Korčula, and in all likelihood, that's the house. He was not really sure, and it was a really funny story, Matko discovering his roots in Brna. And also, I would like to say one thing professionally, what I learned through that process was in terms of a certain academic rigor that I learned from Matko. And it's not just rigor, it's also vigor. It's both at the same time. It's an attitude where you maybe are not lacking in antagonistic spirit, but where you learn how to direct your antagonism at the right target and do it in the right way. And that was, for me, the whole experience of doing this PhD. Now, let's see if technology works. Fantastic. Yeah. My lecture was initially titled The Need for a Utopian Vision. That's a quote from Matko. That was when I asked him about the early stages of new tendencies. What was really the motivation? What was really the core behind this sort of endeavor? And then at this moment, Matko said the need for a utopian vision. And I was thinking about that, and I was trying to sort of feel myself into that thought and what that might have meant at the time. Not what it means now, but what it might have meant at the time. And for me, that's kind of three things which I will try to discuss, not point by point, but which will come up now and then again throughout this lecture. And one thing is really what new tendencies pioneered is the notion of art as visual research. That's so important now. There are so many new courses, new PhD programs, practice-led PhDs, and this notion of art as visual research, I mean, as somebody who I'm not such a great fan of, but even somebody like Peter Weibel has the thesis that if art is to survive at all in this society, then as a branch of science, or as a form of research, and not in its romantic notion of the artist as the outsider and blah, blah, blah. The second point is that new tendencies really pioneered participatory art and relational aesthetics, and I think that's quite commonly known. And the third point, and that's what I think I focus a lot about in my PhD, is the notion of new tendencies made arte programmata, programmed art, but later also actively work with the computer. And in both those phases of new tendencies, which were very different, I think they contributed to an emerging information aesthetics. They developed something that was an art that already anticipated a sort of information aesthetics that has become much more widely known now. It created foundational elements of a way of dealing with aesthetical and artistic matters in the information society which we have now. So back to the title thing. This title is actually a different title. It has been donated by Marco Beljan, the Slovenian artist, who invited me to do a similar lecture tomorrow in Ljubljana. And I think it's much better than my title. So that's why I have adopted it, Programmed Art as Future Generator. It means more or less the same, but in a more poetic, more sort of way. I have done this work as part of a PhD at Goldsmiths, University of London, in art and computational technology. And my own background is that I initially, at least 30 years ago, I was an artist, and that's the only thing I ever properly learned. I'm a trained theater director, and I also had an interest in economics early on, and then for some accident, I became a media artist. I started working with video, with a computer in the 1980s. And as I kept continuing with this work, what I saw was the stage by stage, as the media art was becoming more mainstream and as the information society was starting to become implemented, I saw the complete depoliticization of media art. Also another thing that Darko Fritz has mentioned, it was about like a collective amnesia. In the 1990s, media art was all about being new, about being in the now, about creating the future, but media art did not, or net art, or whatever you call it, had no consciousness, no awareness of its past. So my motivation was to work on the new tendencies because it's relevant today, because I wanted to give media art back its political history. Now, here, I'm very nervous in front of an audience of people who grew up in former Yugoslavia and many experts and philosophers on art from that region and that era. So what should an Austrian guy who doesn't even speak the language tell you, you know? One question really, this is an image from the very first New Tendencies exhibition, and that exhibition kicked it off. It was a moment, one of those rare moments, people come together from different parts of the world and they see something is happening here. We have something in common, we share something. So there was this initial, immediate recognition that this is something that may become a movement or something new. And you can, of course, ask, well, why Zagreb? That's a big chapter in my PhD. I'm not trying to answer it now. Liljana Kolesnik, who I think probably can't come because she's ill, she wrote a wonderful text on that question, and which helped me a lot. But just some sort of the markers. One point, of course, is 1948, Tito's break with Stalin. Another point is the existence of local avant-gardes already in the interwar years, especially in architecture, a kind of modernist, constructivist tradition in Zagreb. But also, I think, very important art historically, an independent form of constructivism that didn't go through the West, but that sort of traveled via Leningrad, Brno, and that's not the village in Korčula, but the city in Czech Republic, and here in Zagreb. So there's an independent notion of a constructivist history that did not have to first go to the West and then be re-imported, which is a very sort of mainstream version, a sort of American-centric version that we all too often hear about constructivism. And as is commonly known, New Tendencies was started through a very serendipitous meeting between Almir Marinier and Matko Mestrovic in 1960. And here, at this point, we need to see also another point about sort of this Western-centric notion of art history. It's a widely foregone, you can read that while I talk about something else. So what I'm talking about is the gestational period of New Tendencies, the years immediately before New Tendencies. And there is a sort of a new, not a new, but a kind of very common mainstream narrative is that the perception that the victory of modernism, of modern art, was a foregone conclusion, and then there is a sort of catching up modernization, a very condescending attitude towards countries in Central and Eastern Europe, that they were sort of, with a time lag, they were behind, and then they were catching up and soaking up these sort of influences. And that's really something that has to be still corrected, and where there still is a very strong need for rebalancing and geographically bringing into context those narratives. If we look at Western Europe, at the time, in the early 50s, for instance, in Austria, there was a book by Hans Sedlmayr in German, The Verlust der Mitte, The Loss of Center, where Sedlmayr basically claimed that because of the death of God, all art had become meaningless. And that was not just modern art or the avant-garde. For Sedlmayr, all art after 1790, all art since the French Revolution had become meaningless because it has lost its center. That book was a bestseller, yeah? Despite the fact that Sedlmayr had a tainted past of association with National Socialism. In 1952, Sedlmayr won the very important Darmstadt debate. The only one holding out against him was Adorno. So at the same time in the United States, you had somebody like Congressman Dondero. And Congressman Dondero had this very funny quote where he equated all kinds of isms in the art, cubism, constructivism, with communism. So all isms in art were bad because that made turned Americans into red devils. And in this situation also, there was another established narrative on modern art, which was that supported by the CIA, the notion that America was better than the Soviet Union because America was more free, because it allowed abstract expressionism. And this kind of narrative was supported by the Congress for Cultural Freedom, and that was actively behind when in the year 1956, an exhibition traveled throughout Europe and also through Yugoslavia that had all the big abstract expressionist names in this exhibition. So we can see in this kind of Cold War narratives, the new tendencies really emerge as something different, occupying a very different space and really situating themselves in between the kind of dominant narratives of this kind of freedom equals abstract gestural painting and communism equals the doctrine of socialist realism, and that there is nothing else in between those things. Now, on a totally different layer, I'm using the work of the English historian Eric Hobsbawm, where he speaks about a geographical area in Europe, which he calls the main mountain ridge of European cultural and economic development. He says, and that's this area that reaches from the north of Italy via southern Germany to the Rhine-Ruhr Valley, Paris, up to London. And he says that's the most dynamic sort of central European area, and you can measure that cultural economic dynamism by the number of Gothic cathedrals and Baroque churches, by the growth rate of gross economic product, and also by the high-tech centers of European industry, and the speed of recovery from the Second World War. And as you can see, Zagreb is only just part of that main mountain ridge of European economic and cultural development. And what I also try to make visible is that the groups and individuals behind NT, they mostly came from those very dynamic areas. So in Milan, one of the most dynamic places in the world, you have to be maybe reminded there was not just the German economic miracle, there was the Italian miracle, which was even stronger, growth rates of 11% for a decade. You had Fiat, you had Olivetti, and you had all those groups and these relationships between art and design with Azimuth, Krupotti, and so on, Munari, and so on. And at the time also you had people like Adriano Olivetti who supported the arts, and as we today had this economic debate, allow me a joke, the whole development can be summed up what we had from Adriano Olivetti to Silvio B. So shows the kind of trajectory.
I'm not quite
And now, what I tried in my work to work out is a kind of historical contextualization. I will talk about that more. But one point behind that boom was not just the recovery from the Second World War, it was also what was then called the American Challenge. That was a term from a French economist, and the American Challenge basically was like a new industrial revolution. It was not just the old industrial society, but it was a new type of industrial revolution based on automation. Not the automation of Henry Ford from the 1920s, but a new type of information using electricity, using feedback, using cybernetic technologies to create much more integrated production systems. And that it was in places such as Milan and Stuttgart and the Rhine Valley where, and Paris, of course, where the Europeans tried to catch up. And that's where also where the new art came from. And what that meant was also a new sort of the rise of a new social structure, you could say. Characteristics have been, for instance, an increased division of labor, automatization, not just on the shop floor, but also in office jobs, and much more closed control loops where advertisement and media and the distribution of goods and all that came together to create a kind of closed control loop of society, the societies of mass production. Now, how to map an art movement, how to deal with the new tendencies. It's massive. It's a sprawling, I mean, just I think by, somebody counted, I didn't count, but by 1969 already 350 artists had participated. How can you find key characteristics or core features out of that multitude of artists, theorists, people involved? And what I did was somehow summed up in that image. I tried a combination of a periodization and of an analysis of structural features or structural characteristics of the era. And in my opinion, this is not a contextualization of the artwork, but something that goes a little bit deeper. So I tried to find key characteristics of the era in terms of the techno-economic paradigms, as I call it, not I call it as some economists call it, and these techno-economic paradigms were somehow developing, they were more than a zeitgeist. These paradigms were a new way of looking at the world. Carlotta Perez calls it a mental map of how to act and how to do things. And I think the new tendencies were really picking up the techno-economic paradigm of this new era of mass production and were somehow transferring that into art, were finding ways of dealing with those latest developments within the area of art. The techno-economic paradigms, as a footnote, it's mostly developed by Chris Freeman from Sussex University, and there are other economists like Luc Sete and Carlotta Perez who have developed this theory, and that has been like a foundational block of my work on the new tendencies. Also, you can see here those funny dots. Those are two curves. So you have the era of Fordism, as it's called, Fordism, Keynesianism, and then you have the crisis of Fordism that starts around 1968. So what I tried to map to do was map the new tendencies onto those curves, onto those developments, to see that new tendencies emerged at a sort of peak period of Fordism, but inside Fordism, new tendencies already developed sort of foundational elements of an information aesthetics, of a new thinking that was already preparing the information society, which was then starting to rise out of the ashes of this Fordist society of mass production. And if you go a little bit further in, in that theoretic, because it was already mentioned today, another economic school, so Chris Freeman and Luc Sete, that's the kind of school of economic innovation. And another school very important for me was regulation theory. And here you can say, like, if you look at key characteristics, so what's the mode of production, what's the regime of accumulation, and how does that shape certain mindsets? And if you look at the kind of theoretical tools that they used, there is this thing that Aglietta has, it's the structural form. And my question that I asked, are there structural forms that you can also apply to the notion of art or to the notion of culture? Is there a relation between the paradigm and between the structural forms that somehow regulate, although regulation means something very different, the production of art? And on the other side, to go a bit deeper into that, is what emerged for me was that I could not address those questions on a big level of big data and many details and facts, and there is no proof to be made. It's impossible to prove that. But I found a layer that was very valuable for me in theorizing that whole thing, and that was the layer of labor, the relationship between intellectual and manual layer labor, and the way how labor and is generally inscribed in society and how it is used. And for that, two books which are visible here have become key sort of notions. One is Harry Braverman, and Braverman's analysis is a continuation of the critique of Taylorism, but he extends it. He doesn't just criticize Taylorism and also picks up the Max Weber's notion of rationalization, but he applies that to the 1970s, and he talks that the key idea is that management takes the knowledge of the labor process from the workers and then embeds it into technology. And this process is the process that continues throughout the 20th century and the process that gathers pace. And it doesn't just happen in the factory, where it already happened in the 19th century, but now it happens with intellectual labor, with office labor. It happens with lower levels of creative labor, people who are drawing, architects, draftsmen, and so on and so forth. All that happens, and that goes into the computer, into this new tool of rationalization. And the other side is this Forces of Production by David Noble, wonderful book. And basically, he explains why the US military funded the development of the computer, of 3D, and of CAD-CAM methods. And it basically, the reason was that the military wanted total control. Workers are trouble, and if we can do everything fully automated with machines, even if it is tremendously expensive, and even if it's a long, 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 long way to go, they found it worthwhile because in the ideological struggle against the Soviet Union, they didn't want to have trade unions, they didn't want to have workers' organization in the military, and so they saw a very big advantage in going this way of total automation, the war without people, production without people. And that is behind a lot of the development of early computer technology in the United States. Now, how long did I talk? Okay, so I have to make a big shortcut. It's always the problem. How do you squeeze a PhD into 30 minutes? Here, on the right-hand side, you see a work by Alberto Bibiasi from Padua, Gruppo N. I chose it because I had hoped Noni Negri would be here. And,
Gianni Colombo,
Carlo. Is it?
Gianni Colombo.
Yeah, on the right side is Bibiasi. On the left side is Gianni Colombo.
Ah, sì.
Okay.
Giusto.
And now coming to this kind of second point, this kind of relational aesthetics. There's this big misunderstanding that most people would call the right picture, they would call it op art. And I think it's totally false, because op art suggests that there were visual effects for their own sake. And with the new tendencies, there was much more behind that. They work with gestalt psychology in order to create a relationship with the viewer. And this relationship was considered to have a sort of and activating, it was about activating people, make them contact with the work, and by that to get them out of those control loops that the automated society was creating. It was about creating consciousness through a relational and participatory aesthetics, not making sort of effects for their own sake. On the left-hand side, you see Gianni Colombo with a floating structuration. It was called, a bit ironically, the art of the little electrical motors. A lot of similar sculptures, there was some electrical motor, and then you turn it on and something happened, sometimes with light, with different things. Here, Umberto Eco comes to our help. At the time when Eco wrote the opera Umberto, first his examples were from painting, were from gestural painting, a little bit also the open score from John Cage and so on. And then he discovered at the same time the Italian participants in New Tendencies and also Nanni Balestrini. And then his kind of definition of the open work shifted to those programmed artworks, as they then were called, with the Olivetti exhibition in 1962. And Eco wrote a very interesting text for that exhibition, which I think sums up a lot of the intentions behind that. So again, it's about creating the artist is somebody who is like a designer who has the plan, he creates the blueprint for the machine, he makes the machine, but that's not the artwork. The artwork only happens in relation to the viewer, and it is not a fixed or determined artwork, but it's an open artwork. It's creating a field of possibilities. Now I have to move on much more quickly. Here, just to say, lots of groups were involved, lots of young people, a lot of collectivism, and while you can read this very briefly, a key moment was in the development of New Tendencies was this kind of near miss between some of the Italian participants and the Operaia movement in the early days. So around 1962, when Olivetti sponsored an exhibition of the key groups that were also involved in New Tendencies, and other people also from Italy, from Vaderni Rossi magazine, Raniero Panzieri, Romano Alquati, they conducted, and I'm glad that you used it, they conducted con ricerca. They went into the factories and tried to find out through co-research, working together with the workers, what were the conditions of increased automation in the Olivetti factory and in the Fiat factory. It was not just a near miss. Later, the two movements found together to some degree, because after Guaderni Rossi stopped, the new magazine was founded, Classe Operaia, and in the early years, Classe Operaia was allowed to meet in the studio of Gruppo N in Padua. And that was a very interesting thing. And then you can also see in the writing of especially Manfredo Masseroni, you can see a lot of those ideas from this early workerist Italian movement were present in the thoughts and in the writing. And maybe a bit too much Italy here, I'm saying that because for me it's kind of drilling in to find an essence, not about the Italy or Yugoslavia. I think those were shared ideas throughout the New Tendencies movement and not just the Italian people. I think Darko is going to talk about this, so we are switching it. Again, very important, here would be another 10-minute excursion into self-managed, self-governed socialism. This is a work by Wenceslav Richter, an illustration of what self-management, self-government would mean, and I think the important point is here to say that these ideas of a non-conformist, different type of small capital socialism, not big capital, not state socialism, not any orthodox Marxism, but a very broad and humanistic interpretation of different types of leftism were the kind of motivation behind the New Tendencies. And in that sense, that's really interesting. You can see the New Tendencies in a much larger historical development. As an American, quite conservative art historian did, Donald Egbert wrote the book Social Radicalism and the Arts, and here the New Tendencies are actually the last avant-garde after a whole range of avant-gardes, starting with Henri Saint-Simon. So New Tendencies are Saint-Simonists, it's absolutely clear. This just briefly to illustrate the relationship between New Tendencies as art and A lot of the participants were in their day job designers, a bit like the relationship between science as basic research and applied science in production. So here, this reliefometer by Richter was like an object with which you could try out different combinations, which then would maybe inspire bigger architectural forms, which then would actually be built. And here, this notion of visual research, I think I have shown the same picture already before in Zagreb, forgive me. But because it's so funny, because it shows you what research means. It's very important theoretically, if you look into this course from science studies, the orthodox idea of science is that science has theoretical assumptions and then it verifies them experimentally. And that's not true. Science studies has shown us that the process is much more messy, and then there are different stages, and the very good approach in that is coming from Andrew Pickering in the book he edited, The Mangle of Praxis. And I would say, in my opinion, the type of research that the new tendencies did, it was not scientific, it was practical, empirical research. The new tendencies were manglers of art. And now, here, actually, the second part of my lecture starts. And to really try to sum it up, this is Abraham Moles. You can say, I mean, the timeline is very tricky. On one hand, if you look at the public side of events, publicly, new tendencies started to deal with this new paradigm of the media, electronic media, the computer, in 1968. But maybe internally, those discussions already started in 1965. And here I find it tremendously important not just to look narrowly at the notion of a computer art, but what new tendencies did. New tendencies, and here it's really Zagreb, it's really mostly the group of curators in Zagreb and Matko, one of the key forces behind that, to create this new discourse on this paradigm change, on this transition from an industrial society to a post-industrial one, or an information society, or whatever you call it. There's, for instance, in one of the BIT International, there's this book by quite a right-winger, is quoted, Brzezinski, with the technotronic age. But this discourse of this transition, of this new that was in the making, and of this new importance or increased importance of the media and electronic communication technologies, that discourse was absolutely pioneered here in Zagreb in a way you could not find that almost anywhere else. I mean, in such an artistic form and in such a sort of condensed matter. I think I really have to stop. There would be more detail. Just one more anecdotal thing. I interviewed Richard Grische, who participated, Austrian artist who came to Zagreb in 1968. And Grische said coming to Zagreb in 1968 was like coming to New York. Not because Zagreb resembled New York, but because of the concentration of very advanced thinkers who shared an interest in those new things, because 68 was not just the year of a global revolt, it was also the year when the computer came out of the closet of the Cold War laboratory. So here, just to flip through, Marinier's raster paintings, this is an information aesthetics, where you could talk more about Abraham Moles and Max Benze and what they did. Here the first computer graphics, and here the notion of a different type of a social computer art, that's five screens with computers by Gustav Metzger. That's something where I think the new tendencies also failed in a certain way. They understood computer as visual research, very often as a sort of flat computer graphics. But there were also projects there, like Gustav Metzger's, that should be a public sculptures using computers and steel projectiles ejecting as a kind of social computer art, which was not recognized in a way. And I think this failure to recognize this possibility of the social computer art also contributed later to the demise of the new tendencies. And here, one last comment. As I talked earlier with this notion of visual research as the manglers of practice, here you can see Frieder Nake with the Zuse Graphomat, one of the first painting machines or drawing machines. And that's a key point to lead back to my theoretical thought. about labor as this core layer of analysis, what we had then and now. We have this narrative about the computer creating seamless sort of transition from the abstract code to the realization. And on that is built a lot about this phantasm of the superiority of thought over manual labor and the whole discrimination we have globally in this separation between intellectual and manual labor. And that's a myth that we have to fight. So if we look at here, at this, Frieda Nagler was a mangler of computer art. This thing was constantly breaking down. Yes, he wrote the code, but it was spilling ink. It was ripping apart the paper, and it took hours to make one drawing. He couldn't go away because meanwhile the machine would go crazy. So these kind of these myths about the seamlessness of programming and realization and about the superiority of this new form of immaterial labor, that's something I think we need to address and discuss more. Okay.